This week on Maker Update, a kid turns his locker into a soda machine, a serious word on laser cutter fumes, printing GIFs, string launchers, a breadboard Arduino Lego brick mashup, contests, and why I'm flying to Iowa. It's Wednesday, February 1st. I'm Donald Bell, and welcome to another Maker Update. Thank you everyone for your feedback last week about that email newsletter idea. It's something I'm gonna get around to eventually, but to hear from you guys, it's not that big a deal, and that the YouTube video notes are doing a good enough job of giving you links to all the things I'm talking about. And I'm glad to hear that. It's honestly less work for me. I'm just gonna focus on making videos. How about that? Although it is getting increasingly hard to do that with this country's political situation taking up so much space in my brain. Honestly, it feels a little bit silly to be making weekly videos on like Arduino powered cat feeders when all I really want to tell you is to like hug your family and build a bunker. But with that said, it is kind of a nice distraction to have this every week for myself and hopefully for you too. I'm hoping that this is a useful, constructive distraction for you. With that said, let's all take a deep breath and take some time to appreciate the project of the week. A 17-year-old Instructables user named Mistablick created this custom coin-operated soda vending machine that fits in his locker. It uses an Arduino Uno, a $30 coin acceptor from eBay, a small LCD, a couple arcade buttons, and two servos that turn a 3D-printed can dispenser. To dress it up, he used the school laser cutter to engrave a design onto black acrylic panels. There's a lot to love about this project. I think for me, number one, it's just such a great, relatable example of a student-led project. It was just a kid thinking, you know what would be awesome? A soda machine in my locker. It's not IoT, it's not connected, there's no app, it's not robotic, it's not a Kickstarter, it's none of the buzzword BS that grown-ups typically hurl at each other, it's just a kid who wants the most awesome locker in school. Once you bait the line with something that cool, everything he has to figure out along the way is worth it. How to make it fit, how to run 12 volts and 9 volt systems side by side, how to prevent theft, how to conserve power, how to prevent the locker from locking, cable management, soda storage, how to use your new invention to ask your girlfriend to prom. Once you have an idea you're passionate about, no matter how silly it might seem, everything else clicks into place. Second thing I love about this project is that it's coin operated. Mr. Blick points to another Instructable I included in the show notes here from a user named Skipped that lays out the basics of integrating an inexpensive coin acceptor into your projects. I love this idea, not just as a way to make money from little Arduino art projects, but as a way to get people literally invested in the result. If this kid just had a button that produced sodas from his locker, that would be neat, but it's something else totally when he has his own legit LCD readout and coin op interface. You know? Alright, and now for some sad news, but important news to share. Last week it was reported that a Berkeley, California couple, Roger and Valerie Marash, both graduates from MIT, died in their home from what is thought to be carbon monoxide poisoning produced by an improperly vented laser cutter. I think this is an important lesson for us to hear, especially as products like Glowforge and its competitors are coming out this year. I know a lot of us are used to having our 3D printers and even CNC mills in our home, and we're used to them being noisy and stinky and possibly even carcinogenic, but not deadly. But with laser cutters, you're literally burning away material and the fumes produced from that can be toxic to breathe. And as we're seeing the market for these pivot from industrial use to home use, with beautiful pictures of them set up in kitchens and craft rooms, I think some people are going to misjudge the danger around fumes. And I don't want to single out Glowforge because I don't believe their product was used here, and I would argue that from what I've seen, they've worked very hard at designing a safe product. But just as an example, out of the three product models they have to sell, their base model, and likely their most popular, is the only one that does not offer an integrated fume filtration system and requires venting out of a window. Which isn't to say that a filtered model is foolproof either, since filters wear out and are expensive to replace, making them easy to neglect. The bottom line is, just be sure to vent your laser cutter. And also invest in some carbon monoxide detectors, both for your home and for your workspace. They could save your life. All right, and now for more projects. This week, Stew Pot McDoodlepip, and I really hope that's his real name, has a video and GitHub tutorial on how to quickly turn an animated GIF into a printable flipbook. His code can be downloaded right from GitHub, along with a link to a cross-platform program called Image Magic that does the heavy lifting. Once you've printed out the frames of your GIF, you then trim them, put them in the right order, clip them, and glue up the spine. It looks like a fun, easy project that would make a great gift. Also, on Thingiverse, I came across this small, 3D-printed, motorized string launcher by Steve Dickey. Steve is a physics and engineering teacher at Divine Child High School in Dearborn, Michigan. This project provides mounts for two battery-powered DC motors and two hubs that fit onto them, spinning in opposite directions. Once a loop of string is introduced, it's transformed into this beautiful, wavy element that's fun to play with. Steve links to another video by a teacher named Bruce Yaney that inspired him with a similar design, but made from wood, so there's two ways to go with this. I think it would be fun to also add a potentiometer in there to dial the speed up and down and see the effect. I also noticed that Bruce's design uses a recycled pair of RC car wheels. I don't know about you, but personally, as a father of an 8-year-old boy, I have a whole drawer of broken RC car parts just waiting for a project like this, so I'm happy I found it. Tips! A lot of things to share this week. First, I saw that SparkFun is taking pre-orders on a project called StemTerra. It's basically a breadboard for circuit prototyping combined with an Arduino Uno all in one package. There's a little more to it. There's a second chip in there that can be programmed for native USB projects. The bottom of the board is Lego compatible, so you can build this into Lego designs. There are additional pins on the board that allow you to stack on Arduino shields. It's a cool idea, especially for students. It's $45 and it sounds like it's shipping soon. Via the Adafruit blog, I found this guide from Dr. Monk on wiring up a simple on button for the Raspberry Pi. It turns out that most Pi boards include a pair of unpopulated pads labeled run that will wake up the Pi from a shutdown when they're momentarily connected. All you have to do is wire up a normally open momentary switch to these pads, either directly or on headers, and you effectively have an on button for your Pi that's arguably more gentle than connecting and disconnecting power. I'm also excited to check out a new book from Make Magazine alum Sean Michael Reagan. It's called The Total Inventor's Manual. It's put out by Popular Science, and it looks like a great visual introduction to inventing, prototyping, crowdfunding, manufacturing, and hopefully profiting from the things that you make. So check that out. I also saw that the kid who made the locker soda machine used a 3D printing service called MakeXYZ based out of Phoenix, and they printed and shipped that little can dispenser mechanism. I hadn't heard of them before, but the pricing on their site looked really competitive, and the site was easier to navigate for me than Shapeways or 3D Hubs. And this isn't a paid plug, it's just a service that's new to me and I thought I'd share it. Contests! Coming up on Unstructables, there are a lot of contests ending soon, including a contest sponsored by Epilogue Laser Cutters that's open to any project type, and it ends on February 6. We also have Bags, Shelving, and Sci-Fi ending that same day. The following week, Duct Tape and Make It Glow are ending. If any of those sound like your thing, get your project wrapped up soon. There are no maker fairs this weekend, so I thought I would take this chance to tell you guys about how I have been invited to give a talk on the maker movement and a hands-on electronics workshop at the Mission Creek Festival, which runs April 4th through 9th in Iowa City, Iowa. My thing will be on the 8th, and I'll have more details on that soon, but I'm really excited and I wanted to let you know early in case you're in the area and wanted to mark the date in your calendars now. You can get more information about the event at missioncreekfestival.com. And that's it for this week's Maker Update. If you're not subscribed already, be sure to hit that button. And with any luck, by the time you're watching this, we will have hit the 2,000 subscriber mark, which is mind-blowing. I remember the slow trickle up to the first 1,000 of you guys and how big that felt, and now it's twice that. It's like we have enough population here for a little maker city. I really do appreciate every one of you guys. It's an honor to come out here every week and be able to feel like I'm talking with a community of smart, creative, positive, geeky people. And it's great. So thank you for that, and thanks for watching, and I'll see you next week.